morning, dear colleagues. This is indeed a very bright light. Now I know what the people, how it feels being here. Okay, it is my pleasure to introduce today's keynote speaker, Dr. Tundi Agerdi. The way I know Tundi, I think she can be considered a model to the ISIS community, and I'm hence very glad she accepted to contribute to our conference. For those of you who do not know her, I would say grab this opportunity. Well, she only stays until lunchtime, but at least that will leave you some time to get in touch with her if you want to have more information. Tundi is the executive director of Sound Seas, a marine conservation policy group that develops initiatives to promote truly effective marine conservation by working at the interface between public policy and community-based conservation. And this at the local level, I think this is quite key. And probably we're going to see some examples in that today as well. She holds a PhD in biological sciences, and she still keeps up with marine scientists to the extent possible. But nowadays, she's more than active as a marine policy and manager advisor. I'm confident that may ring a bell to many of you. What makes Tundi special, to my opinion, of course, is her never-ending enthusiasm about sharing her knowledge and experience as to better ocean management, and her openness to different viewpoints, new insights, and to have it all integrated into her work. Tundi describes herself as a conduit between science and society, with projects in, among other places, the Mediterranean, Caribbean, South America, South Africa. She came in touch with many different societal attitudes towards ocean management. And she learned how to best steer ocean management projects into the direction of science-based marine management. Mastering scientific knowledge and the language, and at the same time understanding the widely ranging societal needs and sentiments, probably is Tundi's key asset. I hope you all agree that this indeed sounds like the ideal ISIS profile, or the ISIS scientist profile. Reflecting on her rich career in ocean management, Tundi will now bring us her thoughts and maybe tips and tricks, we'll see, on presenting science that is accessible to the wider field of actors active in marine management. In other words, science that has impact, and on how to work on the demand side of ocean management. In other words, how to get society interested in the right questions. An understanding of both the supply and demand side of ocean management indeed is most important. This not at least to the ISIS community. Tundi, may I invite you to the floor and present your presentation to us. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Stephen, for that introduction. You actually said many things that I hope I can capture in the talk. I do want to just start by saying I'm really honored to have been invited, and Stephen had a lot to do with that invitation. I also have to admit that I'm a little bit nervous, and the reason for that is in the past decades, I have really given basically two kinds of talks. First and foremost to conservationists with whom I share experiences and sometimes perspectives on marine conservation, marine management. And the other group that I typically speak to are politicians, and we're advised with politicians to assume that the level of education and the attention span is about middle school level. So it's a little bit daunting to be here and talking to you all, highly educated, dedicated, esteemed bunch of scientists. And I just want to say that I'm going to be really reflecting on my perspectives on how to promote the uptake of marine science and marine management. These are perspectives that have been formed from the kind of work that I do in marine spatial planning, in marine protected area design, and in marine conservation. So it certainly doesn't reflect the broad array of views on how to promote the uptake of marine science in management, but it presents my perspective. So if you'll bear with me, I will take you on a little tour of some global experiences in this, and I'd like to address, as Stephen said, both the supply of science that's needed for management as well as the demand for that science and how we can influence both. So if I could have the presentation, thank you. So I want to talk to both the supply and the demand side. I have this aura that interferes with all kinds of electronics, apparently, and this always happens, so there we go. When we talk about marine science that's needed for management, it spans a broad array of different kinds of science. It includes science that comes from field observation, from field experimentation. It includes all kinds, all manners of lab analysis. It might include remote sensing and aerial survey data. And it involves the building of conceptual models, physical models, predictive models, and so forth. So when we talk about science, of course, we're talking about a very wide array of science, and all of you in the room practice many forms of this kind of science. I think in general, as marine scientists, we assume that as long as we provide the information, the scientific information, it will be used. But is it really being used? We have a situation where there are a number of, I think, alarming trends going on, and Kenneth Rose alluded to some of these yesterday. We have a situation where a lot of the expensive long-term studies and the expensive research that's being done on in ocean systems is being done in the Western world by Western world scientists. The scientific findings are being published generally in English, and so the scientific findings are not always accessible to people in the developing world who don't speak English. Many times the scientific findings are published in peer-reviewed journals that are not open access journals, and in many developing countries, the ability to access the regular stream of good science that's coming out is impeded by that. I just want to mention, I work as a contributing editor to MEME, Marine Ecosystems and Management, which is hosted by the platform Open Channels. And the editor of Open Channels publishes each month a list of new findings and new research papers in marine science and marine management, and indicates which of those are open access and available for free, and which of those are paid access, and tabulates the amount that it would cost someone to access all of those journals each month if they had to pay. And the figures are really surprising. So that's just one case where sometimes the access to this scientific information is impeded. But we have another situation also, which is a little bit alarming, and I think has been going on for centuries, which is that scientists from the Western world often go to developing country locations or all around the world into the high seas, collect data, and then don't share the data locally. They take the data back, they analyze the data, they maintain databases in their home institutions, and in many cases, people in those countries, in those places, who could really use that information to affect good local management are not able to access that data. And then lastly, we have this terrible situation, which Kenneth spoke about very diplomatically yesterday, but which I would say in stronger terms, which is that we have a real, not only a resistance to science and to truth, actually, emerging in this country, but a complete backlash against scientific and rational thinking, it seems. And although this is hopefully a temporary, ephemeral phenomenon, it's a little bit alarming because it's undermining scientific institutions in this country, and it's really affecting the morale of scientists in this country. Now, many of you are American scientists, and I think many are not affected by the current administration because you're maintaining your science and able to function. But for many institutions in the U.S. and also for many multilateral institutions, which are providing scientific information and synthesis of scientific information to users all around the world, there's a great fear that these institutions are being eroded by this perspective right now. And though we hope it's, as I say, ephemeral, it is something that I think is affecting the uptake of marine science in management already, even though it's Kenneth said yesterday that it's been around for decades, this kind of backlash against science, but it's certainly coming to a head very recently. So as scientists, we publish our research findings, we produce assessments, we synthesize the information, we even make predictions. But then we're left in a situation where in many parts of the world, we see policy decisions being made, so management policies being implemented that are based on politics or economics and are lacking kind of the scientific, the natural science base. We have, I think, a situation where the supply of science is outstripping the demand for science. And I think that's one of the reasons that we don't see this uptake of marine science that's good science, that's relevant to management, not being taken up by policymakers. So I would like to address this question of how we provide the kinds of science that can meet the demand and how we can also increase the demand for science. Now, I want to mention that I think all the people in this room contribute to good furthering our body of knowledge about marine systems. So all of it is important science. I don't want to say that someone's science in this room is unimportant to management. I think all of it is important because as we broaden our understanding of these marine systems, and as we better anticipate what the future holds vis-a-vis climate changes and other changes, we become more equipped to deal with management problems. But having said that, I think there are some priority areas on the supply side that we should focus on, and in particular that we should focus on communicating our scientific findings about. Linking this kind of supply to the demand, I think, will lead to much more effective management in many parts of the world. And in situations where we have very little demand for scientific information in instituting policies, I think it behooves us to create that demand. And I will get to that later on in the talk of kind of ways that I think we could do that as scientists. But first, I want to concentrate a little bit on the supply side. So how we create supply of scientific information that's useful for marine management. These, again, I have to stop for a second and just with the caveat that this is from my perspective as someone who works primarily in spatial management, so marine spatial planning, ocean zoning, marine protected areas, species conservation that's spatially based. So this is kind of my reflection on what kind of science I have come across around the world that's been really useful for managers who are setting out either to plan policies or to monitor to see how well management policies are meeting their objectives. So a couple of examples of what I feel to be priority science for management. First of all, when we look at a system and we are tasked with trying to figure out how to better manage our impacts upon it, we really need a base understanding of how that system functions. And I want to make the analogy of a kind of a medical analogy because I think the de facto easy way to look at a system is to look at its structure. We spend a lot of time articulating what the structure of these ecosystems are. We spend a lot of time mapping habitats. We spend a lot of time understanding currents and the physical environment. We focus a lot on structure And it's also true on the conservation side that we focus on structure in the sense of we're very focused on high areas of high species diversity or areas of high endemism. These are all kind of structural things that we can tabulate relatively easily or be able to map relatively easily. But what we ultimately are really interested in is not the structure of these ecosystems, but how they function. And in a way, I guess we are lucky as marine people. I mean, we're unlucky as marine people in so many ways, because marine management is a very, very challenging and difficult task. It involves not only regulating our uses of the sea and how we impact the sea directly, but it also involves influencing land use and freshwater use. So we are, in a sense, disadvantaged being marine people, that in the marine management realm is really the entire planet and not just our oceans. On the other hand, we are advantaged by one thing, which I'll make a gross overgeneralization here, and I'll probably be called out on it. And that is that relative to terrestrial ecosystems, I think marine ecosystems, we get a lot of clues about function from their structure. So bottom topography, the location of fronts and upwelling areas and so forth give us a lot of clues about the ecological functioning of a system. I think more so than in terrestrial systems, where the biological interactions are kind of complicate matters more. So in a sense, the structure does give us some important scientific information, of course, but what we're ultimately interested in, again, is the function. And the medical analogy here is, if you have a sick patient, you use the anatomy to tell you something about what's going on with the physiology. But really, ultimately, you don't care much about the anatomy. What you're really interested in is figuring out what's going on with the physiology. Part of that, too, is understanding for the area that you're trying to manage, how is it linked to other ecosystems? Because we know marine systems are open systems. They're very highly linked, not only to other marine ecosystems, but also to ecosystems on land and in freshwater and watersheds. So this is a fundamental question that needs to be answered in order to help managers institute better policies. What are those linkages? And how are they affected by human use? Specifically, what areas are critical to maintaining ecosystem functioning and productivity? Again, back to the medical analogy, if you have a sick patient, you're going to look at the vital organs first and foremost. You're not going to be concerned that the person has a cut on his finger or an abrasion on the knee. You're really going to be concerned about what's affecting the heart, the lungs, the liver, the vital organs of the system. And if we as ecologists can identify where those vital organs of the ocean system are, we can target our research and ultimately our management on trying to maintain those critical functioning areas. Another critical question, of course, which all of you seem to be involved in, is how anthropogenic pressures, including not just the use of marine areas and the extraction of resources, but also indirect effects, so anthropogenic activities and impacts that originate from watersheds or from land, how these affect the ecosystem's functioning and ecosystem health. I'm nervous to use the term ecosystem health because I know it's not very scientific and it's been debated. I think it's a very useful communication tool to talk about ecosystem health, but really to focus on, again, the physiology of these systems, how they operate, how they function, as opposed to the structure. And then finally, and it's critically important to think about synthesizing the information that we have, some of it historic, going back millennia, some of it historic, going back decades, to make projections into the future. And this is particularly true, I've heard yesterday almost every talk mentioned something about climate change, and I know all of you are involved in trying to anticipate how climate change is going to affect the habitats, the species, the systems that you work in. And not just climate change, but there are other global change phenomena going on. There are going to be new emerging uses of the marine environment, some of which may accelerate very, very quickly and catch us unawares. And certainly the cumulative impacts of a lot of the anthropogenic stresses on these systems in many cases are going to reach threshold levels where we might see fairly significant changes to ecosystems, phase shifts or other kinds of massive changes. So it's critically important for us to understand what is making this patient sick, in the medical analogy, but it's also critically important for us to understand if we send this recovered patient back out into the world, how is he or she going to fare into the future? What does the future hold for these already stressed ecosystems, even the ones that we start to manage in a better way? So that takes us, those kinds of general questions, the kinds of questions that I think scientists can provide information on, take us to a couple of, a smattering of kind of research themes, broad themes, that I'd like to talk to you about and provide specific examples on how the information is supplied by scientists and how this particular kind of information is readily taken up by planners and managers who are trying to better, more effectively manage the marine environment. We all work in different kinds of biomes, in different kinds of habitats, under different kinds of conditions. But I see a kind of pattern that emerges in kind of these thematic groups of applied science that's very useful for management. So the first area I'd like to speak about is this idea of being able to identify critical areas. And critical areas we can think of as, again, being like the heart, lungs, and liver of the ocean organism. We can think of that more specifically vis-a-vis specific species in the kind of traditional sense of critical areas, such as some of our legislation requires us to do, critical essential fish habitat or critical areas for endangered species. We can think about critical areas in a different way, though, too. We can think about areas that are critical for certain kinds of human uses. So in a sense, this isn't just about ecological criticalness. I don't know if that's a word, actually. Is it a word? Criticalness. But we can also think about use and critical things like if you have a port, you need access to that port, and there aren't a lot of choices in terms of being able to access the point. So immediately offshore from a point, you may have an area that's critical for shipping, for instance. Or, as Stephen mentioned, I have found myself becoming more and more involved in understanding societal perspectives on the marine environment and on nature. And some critical areas are critical because they're culturally important, because they're sacred sites, because they are areas that contribute to human well-being in ways different from livelihood or fisheries revenues or so forth. So broad gamut of ways that we can define areas as being critical. But being able to identify what areas are more important than other areas in a system is a really useful set of information for managers. I'll provide just two examples here, specific examples. On the left, you see a map of one of the atoll groups in the Maldives. And in the Maldives, there is a very, very large industry based on marine tourism, well, on tourism in general, I should say, mass tourism also, some of it being dive tourism, all centered on the coral reefs and the coral reef species. But you also have, as the second largest source of GDP in the country, an extensive Poland line tuna fishery. And the Poland line tuna fishery is highly sustainable. and it utilizes bait fish that come from the atolls. So even though it's a pelagic industry, it has this connection to the coral reefs. And given the situation with global tourism and the risks involved with tourism, putting all of your eggs in the tourism basket, the Maldives government is interested in finding ways to plan their marine space so that they accommodate tourist development growth while at the same time sustaining the fisheries. And so we did an ecosystem services assessment in this atoll group to identify specific areas that were important not only for future tourism, and it, of course, we as conservationists were kind of peddling the idea that ecotourism was a better source of revenue generation for the Maldives and a more sustainable way to develop tourism in the Maldives than mass tourism. So we were identifying places that could be critically important for sustaining and enhancing their dive tourism industry and other kinds of ecotourism. But at the same time, we were interested in safeguarding the bait fish that are used in the Poland line fishery. And we were trying to avoid the situation that exists in the Maldives where they're doing a lot of land reclamation, destroying coral reefs in order to create land to build big resorts. Because we explained that if you destroy these critical areas, you're not only destroying the opportunities for future ecotourism, but you're also impacting your fisheries and the potential for getting bait fish in the future. Anyway, long story, it's kind of ecosystem services perspective on how to identify critical areas. On the right is something maybe that resonates with you all more, which is just this idea of this is Farmer et al. In an area close by to where we are right now, to predict where you're going to see spawning fish. This is red snapper, but this has been done for a lot of different species. This is not observational, this is predictive modeling, so it's predicting where there are going to be critical areas. And I don't have a slide to share with you, but I do want to mention something that I'm working on in the Mediterranean, which is related to this idea of predictive modeling of important habitat. We have a situation in the Mediterranean which is interesting. The largest marine protected area in the Mediterranean is the Pelagos Sanctuary for the Conservation of Mediterranean Marine Mammals, known as the Pelagos Sanctuary. It's a very, very large, trilaterally instituted marine protected area in the Ligurian Sea, so just north of Sardinia. It encompasses all of Corsica, and it goes from France over to Italy and includes all of the coastal waters. The protected area was established to protect marine mammals, and it's a noteworthy protected area because it's the first protected area in the world that had a high seas component. So it was done by France, Monaco, and Italy together, working together, and they established this protected area that included Mediterranean high seas. I mention it because, unfortunately, as it turns out, when they established the protected area in 1999, the marine mammals were solidly within the boundaries of the Pelagos Sanctuary. Now, most of the fin whales and other whales spend very little time in the sanctuary. In fact, they're spending time in areas to the west, all the way over to the Balearic Islands, Mallorca, and so forth, and up in the Gulf of Lion. Sorry that I'm talking about these places without a map, but we just started working on this now, and I just want to mention it because we have this idea that we can identify the areas where these marine mammals are feeding that we've done, and we know from aerial senses where they are, and we know that they're not spending that much time in the reserve. Rather than trying to redo the reserve, which has its own historical significance and its own political significance, we are trying to propose a kind of system where we can predict where the whales are going to be in the coming year and create moving or dynamic protected areas that kind of are paired to this big Pelagos Marine Reserve. And I just want to mention this because it's something, now I'm getting into the talk about marine protected areas and marine spatial planning, so I have to slap myself and get off that topic. But I just want to mention it because I think we have the scientific tools now to be able to do this very, very useful kind of predictive modeling, in where we can take information that's available to us today and say in the coming year we expect these whales to be feeding in this place, therefore we'll set up a temporary kind of closure of sorts around this small area in order to protect where the whales, we think the whales will be in the coming year. So I just want to mention that the idea of these kinds of critical areas might be moving around, and in fact we all know, because we're all familiar with ecology and the dynamics of these systems, all of these things are changing constantly. So we need to anticipate these changes, not only identify where critical areas are today, but where they might be in the future. Okay, the next kind of clumped thematic group of research that I think is really important for marine management has to do with connectivity. So again, thinking about how a certain ecosystem or habitat is connected to other ecosystems and habitats, how species move in between different kinds of habitats, but also thinking about the connections between humans and these ecosystems, and what the degradation of these ecosystems, what kind of impact that has on human well-being. So connectivity, again, like critical areas, I think of as in very, very broad terms. Just one example of this is Pete Mumby's work in articulating how important the presence of mangroves is to coral reef fishes. And what he did in his work was the mapping that showed where these mangrove areas were in fact providing nursery habitat for coral reef fish species and so forth, and kind of mapping the flows more or less. Now, subsequent work has not called into question Mumby's findings, because I think the findings are very solid, but it turns out there's more plasticity in many of these systems than we thought. So Simon Thorold's work, for instance, in the Red Sea, showing that if you do take away one of these habitat types, seagrass, for instance, which is a connecting habitat between mangrove and coral reef, many of the species can adapt and can utilize other kind of substitute habitat types. It complicates matters for us on the policy side because, you know, we want to have these very clear statements about how important it is to preserve these particular kinds of important habitats. But in any case, this being able to articulate this connectivity, being able to anticipate what happens when we interrupt these connections or sever these connections, is really critically important for management. The third area or thematic kind of research area that I think is really useful for management is articulating what sustainable levels of use are for a particular system. And of course, when I say that, immediately everybody thinks of fisheries, and I know that most of you in the room are involved in ecosystem approaches to fisheries management or articulating what MSY levels are and so forth. Very, very important. But when we talk about sustainable levels of use, we need to remember it's not just about resource extraction, not just about fisheries. We need to be thinking about carrying capacity, for instance, for how many tourists you can pack into a sensitive, vulnerable area and still maintain the ecological health of that area. For certain species, you know, what kinds of interactions with those species are appropriate and at what levels. So I could go in any number of directions with this to provide examples, and because all of you work on this topic, I think, I didn't really want to talk too much about fisheries, but I did want to mention this this paper of Seitz et al. That came out in 2014, because it spurred a lot of subsequent work on trying to understand where critical habitats were for production of commercially important species, and then tie the condition of those habitats to the production. So we see many, and this was in Europe, so we see that European coastal habitats are now very well mapped, and we have a good sense, I think, of their condition in most places, and understanding how that condition then affects commercially important species affects our ability to give good advice to fisheries managers and others on how to manage for sustainable use. So the fourth, I think I'm on four. I should have numbered these, but I think I'm on four. The fourth thematic area is predicting ecosystem responses to certain management interventions. And in particular, predicting ecosystem responses to management interventions in light of a changing climate and a changing world. So some of this involves complex modeling. Sometimes it involves artificial intelligence and things that I have that is so far over my head that I don't even know how they, how they structure the algorithms, let alone how they create the models. But it also involves more simple kinds of ways of communicating this information that involve narratives and involve telling stories about the future based on our collective experience on what's happened in the past. So whether this is trying to predict the response of an ecosystem to the establishment of a no-take reserve or the establishment of a protected area that's meant to protect a particular kind of habitat from being degraded or destroyed, how that will change with sea level rise, how that will change with ocean acidification, with warming, with increased cumulative impacts, which are inevitable in, I think, all parts of the world, is something that really managers are, astute and progressive managers are trying to get information on. And again, I could mention a lot of probably your own scientific findings from people in this room. I just mentioned this one study which has been really very well taken up by policymakers in Belize. This is the Natural Capital Project, Marine Invest. And they went into the Belizean coastal zone and they mapped the habitats, and they were looking specifically at four ecosystem services that the habitats provide, including fisheries production, shoreline stabilization, tourism, the potential for tourism support, and so forth. And what they did was, once they'd mapped these ecosystem services attached to habitats and the quality of habitats in Belize, they were then able to do these trade-off analyses, these scenarios, where they, in very, very simple terms, they created three alternative futures. The first one was a conservation future in which decision makers elected to protect wide swaths of mangrove, of seagrass, of coral reef, not just with protected areas, but with other kinds of rules and regulations. Then they had the other extreme, which was all hell-bent on development, just take it all down, put in, coastal resorts and golf courses and use the timber from mangrove forests and, extreme development scenario. And then they had the compromise scenario that is halfway in between the two. And what they were able to show with their models, very simple terms, in terms that decision makers in Belize could very quickly understand, is the kind of trade-offs involved with, for instance, a conservation approach. It costs money to conserve these places. It costs money to do enforcement patrols, to do everything that's involved with management, and what are the benefits that flow out from that versus development, doesn't cost much money to the government to allow development to take place, but the costs in terms of the loss of services are enormous. So this is just one example of thinking about the future. There's many, many different ways to think about the future, and as I say, there are many much more robust, scientifically robust ways to develop predictive models. This one I thought was really illuminating because it has been used by decision makers in Belize. Another interesting way of looking at the future is to map ecosystem service benefit flows to really understand not only what kinds of services these habitats are providing in terms of biodiversity, in terms of fisheries production, in terms of shoreline stabilization, but also where did those benefits go? Who is benefiting from them, and where did the benefits flow to? And that's really interesting work, especially when you try and predict into the future of how those benefit flows will change over time. Okay, I think this is the last category of research that I wanted to talk about to you today on the supply side, and that was is assessing values. Now, when I say assessing values, immediately everybody thinks, uh-oh, here comes the economic valuation. And that's not what I mean. In many cases, we do valuation and we do economic valuation in order to influence a decision maker to, because I'm a conservationist, I wear it on my sleeve, I have an agenda, and my agenda is to convince decision makers to opt for the conservation scenario as opposed to the development one. But when I say assessing values here, that's not what I mean. I don't mean economic values. I mean more assessing what kinds of values the different parts of the ecosystem, the different components of the ecosystem provide to the ecosystem of which humans are a part. And I just provide one example that came from Stephen, which is this biological valuation in Belgium. This is something that the Belgians have been doing for decades on land. And this actually, this marine biological valuation was done probably 10 or 15 years ago now. This, again, is not an economic valuation. It is a mapping of how the different components of the Belgian coastal waters contribute to the biology of the Belgian coastal waters. And this information was then used, being combined with a lot of different other kinds of information. So there wasn't a direct jump from the biological valuation to this management proposal, which was New Habitats Directive Area, which was instituted. But it did influence this Habitats Directive Area. So this was biological value information that then got taken up by planners in this Habitats Directive Area, which was instituted. So there are many, many examples of this and many, many papers that have been written about also the economic side of valuation. But I don't want to emphasize the economic side because I think we tend to skip over the important ecology and understanding the biological value of these places when we want to jump immediately to the monetary values. And so I recommend that we spend more time trying to understand the biological value of places and incorporate that into our synthesized information that we provide to policymakers. In order to do that kind of valuation, though, we really can't be working as natural scientists alone. And Kenneth Rose talked about team science yesterday, and these multidisciplinary team approaches are really what's needed to understand values in the marine environment. Working together with social scientists, we can pinpoint these areas of greatest value to humans because that's going to resonate with decision makers. We can also generate a lot of political will, and here we get away from being scientists and becoming more like advocates. But we can use the science to generate political will, and we can also use the science to get better integrated management, because we can use the science to address these issues of connectivity and break down these silos that we still have in so many places in the world, these silos that make us stuck in this kind of sectoral management approach. So trying to use the natural social science to develop institutional frameworks for integrated management. These institutional frameworks might be involving different agencies of government. In Mexico, in Pacific Mexico, I work a lot with the Water Authority, which is, and this is fresh water, drinking water. It's not something I ever thought I would be doing, but something I don't know very much about. But it's just one example of how the marine management requires us to address issues of water consumption up in the watershed. And if we think about the connectivity, then we can start to institute these kinds of policy frameworks that make sense for the ecosystem. So that's my perspective on the kind of landscape of science that's useful for management, that we should be supplying and that we should be also communicating in ways that managers and decision makers can understand. But I also want to mention one thing, which is that I don't think we spend enough time harnessing our science in order to understand what is the problem that we're trying to fix with management. Of course, this varies from place to place. And some places do this quite well, this kind of problem scoping. But in other places, we don't spend a lot of time problem scoping. And I'm going to say something heretical here. I'm used to being kind of a pariah in the conservation community, so I'm used to saying these kinds of things. But the heretical thing I want to say is that as conservationists, now I speak not as a scientist, but as a conservationist, a lot of times we do skip over that problem-solving step because we have a solution in our back pocket that we desperately want to apply. And sometimes this is a function of conservationists working for NGOs that are branded as doing a certain kind of thing that they do well, and they want to do it everywhere. Part of it is to attract funding, and part of it is to raise their profile in the competitive world of conservation NGOs. But this isn't true only for NGOs, so I think there is this kind of knee-jerk reaction. We have now a long experience with using certain tools in the marine environment to achieve conservation outcomes, like marine protected areas, and we are very eager to apply those tools everywhere, sometimes without understanding the problem, sometimes applying that tool in a place where a protected area is not the appropriate response to the problem. So, okay, there I've said it. You can argue with me after the talk. I hope to leave some time for argument and questions. Just want to quickly, before I end, talk about the demand side and how we as scientists can influence the demand for scientific information. In general, marine managers ask these kinds of questions. What areas should be off limits to development? What levels of use are appropriate in certain areas? How will the costs of management compare to the benefits that are going to flow from management? We should be willing to provide those answers as best we can, and I know it's very difficult because I know as scientists we're true to you know, understanding uncertainty and not wanting to go into hyperbole, not wanting to make statements that we can't substantiate. On the other hand, we also know that these management decisions are being made, and unless we step up and start providing answers more aggressively, these management decisions will be made in absence of science. So we, as scientists, need to guide managers to help them ask the right kinds of questions. We need to be creating narratives, to create stories, to publish in non-traditional places, and not in peer-reviewed journals, but more in mass media or more in practitioners' kinds of media, to demonstrate how science can reduce science-based decision making can reduce risk and can promote management efficiency. Like, we need to be talking in the language that managers understand and demonstrating why it's a good policy to base the policy on science. And we need to highlight examples where management failures and wasted money resulted from ignoring science. And that's difficult to do. Nobody likes to publish on failures, and it's a very dangerous business to go around pointing to management failures. You quickly start to get your visa denied in a lot of places when that happens. But I think we in the scientific community need to do this in order to create better demand for our product. It also might require that scientists go into venues and fora that they're not familiar with or uncomfortable in. The UN Oceans Conference, you know, saw a lot of, probably many people in this room were there, but we need to have a bigger science presence in these kinds of fora, not just conservationists, not just people who are policymakers or planners or conservationists. We need to have the science present there. We might also need to become science advocates, and I know Kenneth warned against that yesterday and said that we need to be careful. I kind of disagree with him. I mean, I think we need to be careful, but I think we need to take responsibility to defend science wherever we can, and I think we need to do that as individuals, as parents, not as people representing the scientific community. I think that's always a mistake. I think we need to become advocates for our own children, for our own selves, for the planet that doesn't have a voice. So it's not for everybody, but I think everybody in this room should be concerned about if and how their science is being used. Just want to end by mentioning a couple of ICES contributions to both the demand, the supply and the demand of scientific information. First, I just want to mention this ICES ecosystem-based management initiative, which is supplying evidence for ecosystem-based management, something we all talk about as if we're doing it, something that's very difficult to achieve in practice. But the ICES contribution to this on the supply side is really important. Also on the demand side, now Stephen provided me with this, what are called ICES viewpoints, these particular research areas where it's not just supplying information, but it's also influencing the management questions that are being asked and how the science is being used. So I wanted to mention those two ways that ICES and all of you contribute to both the supply side and the demand side. We are in this kind of difficult situation now where we're trying to balance the science, the supply of science with the demand for science. And it's really society as a whole that needs to balance that. We really need to think about ways to get society to better respect science, to better use science. We need to have that go all the way through to managers so that they ask questions and demand those kinds of science that we can supply. And we have responsibilities also to really focus on the demand and to really start communicating in ways beyond our kind of peer group, beyond ICES meetings and so forth. So that we can make sure that that demand grows into the future. So with that, I'd like to quit, and I think we have about 6 minutes for questions. Thank you very much. Do you have any questions? It's difficult to see, but there's a hand there, I think.
I have already a mic.
Oh, good. Perfect.
This was a very nice talk. Thank you very much. But maybe some of us know the Lake Kariba example described by Jeppe Kolding et al. And that is a lake in the middle of Africa, divided into parts. One part is managed, and the other part is completely unmanaged. Everybody is doing what she or he thinks what is good for him. So, and in the unmanaged part, the yield is 6 times higher than in the managed part. So, that leads us to the question, what is good for the management? If we are interested in lower yields, lower salaries, starving people, okay, managing the lake is a good thing. But if you are interested in sustainable food supply, yeah, take what you need. Could you speak about that?
Well, I don't know the example myself, but it sounds fascinating, and I think you're right to bring up the question of what are the objectives of management, and do we, in this particular case, you have this bizarre situation where no management is leading to better outcomes for the fisheries side. I guess I would ask whether there are other uses that are being preempted, perhaps, by the fishing, or are there opportunities in the future that are being preempted by the unmanaged area? Perhaps it's just the wrong form of management, and there you go. And that might be an example, not coming from the conservation community, but coming from the management community, where we have the tailored solution in the back pocket, and we apply it without understanding what the needs and objectives and problem is in that particular place. So thank you for mentioning it. I'll take a look, and I'm curious now to hear the full story.
Over here? You told me to go first?
Okay.
You can go first. Me? Okay. Dorothy Dunkel from the University of Bergen. Thanks for your talk. I'd like to relate your last slides with your first slides in problem framing, because I totally agree that we need to do more and better problem framing. Mm-hmm. But then we have to ask, how do we actually do that problem framing? Who is doing it, with whom, for what purpose? And I think I didn't quite get from your talk the difference of scientists framing problems for policymakers, kind of like the deficit model. If they only knew what we knew, then they would do it. And then scientists working in larger groups, extending the peer community to problem frame with the people that the management decisions will actually affect. The difference between us as very privileged, educated, white people, basically, scientists telling other people what to do. So if you can maybe reflect on that, who should be at the table and at what time?
Yeah, it's a really good question and comment. And I would say, so in the realm that I work in marine spatial planning, and really marine spatial planning as a kind of way to achieve ecosystem-based management, so one of the tangible ways that we try to do ecosystem-based management, we spend a lot of time on the kind of visioning stage, which is a participatory visioning. So, I mean, now I get into something that probably is going to make a lot of your eyes roll. But the idea that to be able to figure out what is both the problem that needs to be solved, so the problem scoping, and also the desires for the future, what kind of outcomes one hopes to achieve with the initiative. The best way to do that is early on, before a plan is developed, obviously, of any kind of plan or policy, and with as many stakeholders as possible. Now, it becomes complicated, and I don't want to sound Pollyannish about this. When we have participatory planning of any type, we use representatives who represent certain viewpoints or uses. It's inherently dangerous and risky to do that, because these people often don't represent full sectors. I'm always just stunned to see, for instance, in a planning session where they have the commercial fisherman, it's usually a man, fisherman representing all of commercial fisheries. Obviously that doesn't work, but as much as possible to identify who has a vested interest in improving the management and what is the management problem that needs to be solved. That is something where scientists can be brought in alongside users and other stakeholders, and to do that in a participatory way. The other way is to rely on kind of this more benevolent dictator model, which is you have a government agency that is progressive and can develop the big picture and proposes something, but you know, inevitably, these processes, even if they're very well thought out, and even if the plans that are generated solve a management problem without the buy-in of a lot of stakeholders in the process, these can be rejected later on. So I think what I would say to that is I think scientists can participate in two ways. One is to be involved in team science or try and work in multidisciplinary ways and also communicate those findings in a way that can resonate with people that are not scientists. And then secondarily, to become personally involved in some of these processes and to be a seat at the table and to offer your information and your knowledge as these processes start to be developed and framed out. I can't even see your reaction, so I don't know if you're if you're really depressed or disappointed in my answer.
I'm afraid that we are somewhat running out of time.
Yeah,
so
no worries.
But then you will be around at well during coffee break until lunchtime. So
no, I'll be here through lunch. So and yep. I'm happy to speak with anyone at lunchtime as well. So yep. Thank you very much.
So thank you very much for your stimulating thoughts on and yes. Very good.